We're here at NEWFM with a real nice visit from the Boomtown Rats, Bob Geldof and Johnny Fingers.
Howdy.
From what we were told, you got a new contract, like you just said, here in the States. So you're going to be releasing an album here within the next couple of weeks, I think, right?
Yeah.
That's right.
Make a change. We did have an album out last year, but nobody knew about it. This one will be hopefully different. People will actually know about it, whether they buy it or not, or something else.
Is this new thing going to have any new material, or is it a compilation of the past two records?
There's two tracks off the first album, which nobody ever heard about here. Those three people,
but you actually got it, will feel a bit ripped off, but the other 200 million of you won't feel too bad.
Uh-huh.
It's called A Tonic for the Troops, and it's been out about 7 months in Europe, where it did rather well. And we waited this long to release it in the States, mainly because we were looking for an out from Mercury Records, and we were looking for an alternative record company, and we finally found, I suppose, what we were looking for with CBS. So we just signed with them just prior to Christmas, and they're releasing the album around February. We'll also be over to tour the standard band stuff.
You're going to be doing a nationwide or just an East Coast as far
two and
as performing?
2.5 months, so I assume that'll take in most everywhere. We're doing, Johnny and myself are over to do about 16 cities this month.
Yeah. On the promotional tour, and then we'll be back.
But you're just off a tour over in Europe, right?
Yeah, in fact the last year and a half has just been a constant tour, more or less. But in Britain we finished on 15th of December, and we did TVs and stuff up to Christmas, and then went home for Christmas, and then came straight over here.
Yeah.
So,
what do you have for Christmas dinner, Bob?
That's a silly question, John.
Yeah, but the last one.
We just, as I said, like the last year has been very good for us in England. There were three tracks off the album released in England. She's Someone, Like Clockwork, and Rat Trap. All three of which went top 10, and Rat Trap went to number one, so that was quite good. Just prior to Christmas, it was number one.
Uh-huh.
And then...
What's taken its place at this point?
Rod Stewart has taken its place, took its place, but prior to, we took John Travolta's place, it was a bit of a David and Goliath situation, because they were number one, two, and three,
right.
And we jumped over them, and it's very difficult to beat some people who've got a promotional film playing in every flea pit in the country during the kids' school break. And we managed to do it, and so we felt inordinately proud of ourselves. And then we were number one for a couple of weeks, and Stuart came along with that hideous record, Do You Think I'm Sexy? No is the answer. And got to number one, stayed there for 1 week. Yes, 1 week at the top. And I don't know what's... Oh, YMCA is number one there now.
What's happening in the place where you're from in Ireland as compared to what's going on in England with your records and stuff?
No, in Ireland we're heroes. I mean, they practically give us the freedom of the city and name streets after us and things. That's not exactly true, but I mean, the national TV had awards and we won 4 out of 9 of the awards, and well, it's a big thing because
these are music
it's
awards.
It's the prodigal son.
Yeah, music awards. Yeah. Yeah.
In England, it's very good for us. At the moment also, like, we do get a lot of things like that, but normally it goes beyond that. There's sort of national pride that the local boys make good, that sort of thing, which is ridiculous.
I think is the word I'm looking for.
Where are you based out of now? I mean, do you still...
London. Well, you have
you're
to be.
Living there?
It's like if you're a band in the States, I think you have to center yourself around New York or LA, because
right.
they're the centres. And like it or not, London is the centre of the thing in Europe.
Mm-hmm. What listening do you do when you're in a kind of situation where you're not working as far as records? What are you guys big fans of?
And what bands do we like?
Aside from the Rats.
Or radio.
Yeah.
Well, you don't have a wide choice in England, that's the first thing. So we don't usually listen to the record during the day. It's usually, again, sort of top 40 programming on the BBC. And the independents are a bit more flexible, but then again, they don't do very much except MOR. Mm. Except at night time, you get some sort of the equivalent of FM stuff. Record-wise, I listen to anything I like. I mean, if Foreigner ever brought out a record I liked, which is highly unlikely, I'd probably listen to it and probably say it was a good record, but it strictly goes on what I like. Like, I don't say that I have favourite bands, with the exception of maybe Bowie.
Mm-hmm.
And if he brings out a bad record, then I'll just say it's bad. If somebody brings out a good record, that's what I listen to at that time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that's my sole criteria. That's yeah. the only thing that interests me about bands. I couldn't care what lifestyle they live. It's just purely down to what songs, if they're good, if they're relevant, if they're doing something new, if it sounds good, that's the only criteria I use.
You, Johnny, I read something about you recently that we were talking about a little while ago in a British paper called Sounds.
Yeah.
I think this happened when you were on tour. You were in Berlin, and
yeah, that's
as
right.
you are known for, you were wearing pajamas and actually got arrested for doing that.
Yeah, that's right. What happened was we had a day off in Berlin, in West Berlin, and think about and we went over to the east because we, like, I always wanted to see the east, you know, and just to have a look at the other side, I suppose.
Communists. They're all reds. They can tell you for nothing.
That's what's wrong with the weather. Russians, missiles, they're not.
And we were just going around different places when we got in, and I was surrounded by secret police, and they took me off and brought me to this kind of police station, you know. And locked
what
the door.
What did they say to you when they were taking you off?
Well, listen, like
they couldn't speak English.
No,
really?
None of them could speak English.
So you actually had no idea what was happening?
No, like, I mean, I thought it was something like Mission Impossible, you know. When are the rest of the band going to break through the door, you know?
We were outside and, like...
But it sounds funny now, but, I mean, it was hilarious then. No, it was really scary because they had just kind of blank faces, really cold. They just looked at my visa as if it was invalid, you know. And
the funny thing about it, they
just start dialing different places, and kind of a guy came in with a suitcase, and he just looked at me, walked over and washed his hands and walked out, you know, and this kind of thing.
Or were they trying to base it on suspicion or something because of your wardrobe?
Yeah, exactly. That's what it is.
Like, the funny thing about East Berlin, though, is that you have to kind of pay into it like you go to a movie. And you get up to the border, Checkpoint Charlie, and the American forces control that section of the city. And right beside the Checkpoint Charlie, the American place, there's a tourist shop run by the American army, and a sort of display about how guys escape from East Berlin, which is pretty horrendous. If you saw the place, you'd want to try any means to get out. And not that we're rabid anything else, that we don't hold to any particular ideology. This place just frightened us.
Mm.
And so we passed through Checkpoint Charlie and got to the other side. And we had to queue up to pay our money to get into East Berlin. And there was this Rosa Klebb. Do you remember the Dr. No movie? Do you remember Rosa Klebb? She had a knife in her shoe. Well, there was this Rosa Klebb type character there.
Oh, yeah.
And Johnny went over and he went, "Hello, darling." And she said, "I am not your darling." And
So we were all laughing and carrying on. I mean, there were quite a lot of us. And she said, "So you are happy, yeah?" And we said, "Oh, I suppose so." And she says, "You can afford to laugh?" I mean, it was like something out of a movie.
That's what
it?
I was going to say. It sounds like the film that I mentioned before that you said
it's
you
like From Russia
yet,
with Love, you know, one of those kind of
things. Either that or Midnight Express.
Right.
I mean, grabbing you and...
So then they took our passports, and he was in his pajamas, and... I think at this point we better explain that Johnny Fingers wears pajamas all the time. I mean, that's what he chooses.
What do you
wear
to bed?
Street I'll tell
clothes?
You about that later.
A three-piece suit. But,
okay.
So we got in, and you have to pay five German, West German marks to get in because each mark is worth 11 East German marks. And
to get into the country.
Yeah, so they want hard Western currency, so that's why you must pay. You must also change a minimum of 11 West German marks after paying your five before you're allowed in. So they make about, you know, 60 marks from each person. And
this is a constant stream of tourists as well, you know. Like, I mean,
so next minute a guy came along and just singled Fingers out and said, "Come at me," or said, point at the picture and point at him. Johnny nodded. He said, "Right this way." And they found out that our manager is an ex-journalist because it's still in his passport. So they freaked about that, and they said, "We don't want any bad publicity out of this. And you know, we'd like to let him in, but I'm afraid we consider him a madman." That's the actual words they use. Mm. And he was sitting there in this table with this naked light bulb and a brown scrubbed wooden table by himself with this mirror in front of him, you know, through which we assume people were looking. And he'd given up smoking, so that afternoon he went back onto them. So this guy came out, and I said, "Look, if you came into the West in that uniform, we consider you a madman. So, but nobody would arrest you, Nick." And I said, "What would happen if an East Berlin citizen walked through the streets?" He said, "Oh, we'd take him to hospital."
Really?
Yeah. So he said, Faulkner, who's our manager, then said, "Well, why don't you give him one of your uniforms he could wear?" And they said, "Okay, we'll see." So we thought, great, what a great press scam. Here's Fingers walking around East Berlin in this East German guard's
uniform. It was a great story to read.
So next minute, in walks a Russian who shouted at these Germans, and they all fled. And so Fingers eventually was allowed out, and then they got our tour manager, who's dressed like an English sort of rocker, and they'll tell you about grease back hair and leather jackets and all that. Mm-hmm. And he was pulled. They took pictures of us all and stuff like that. Then we walked up the Unter dem Linden, which is one of the big streets there. And it's weird because there's still World War II ruins there.
Yeah.
And it was the perfect day for visiting East Berlin. It's just like that John le Carré book, The Spy Who Came In from the Cold. Wet, grey and dreary.
Like, it was Sunday afternoon and there's nobody around. And there was, like, in the shop windows, there's all these pictures of cosmonauts and things like that.
Yeah,
and
solidarity between these German and Russian cosmonauts. So we went up to the Brandenburg Gate and we saw the old ruins around the place. And, like, they had sort of begun to build maybe 20 years ago and then given up. And you see a tree growing out the top of a bit of scaffolding. You know, funny things like that. So then we walked past the war memorial, which is guarded by Russians, and they goose-step up and down. That was quite a nice memorial. Mm-hmm. And then we went up to their Pride and Joy, which is the opera house, and it's right beside the Reichstag, which is bombed out and burned and hasn't been changed. And the opera house is beautiful. It's a huge, vast glass building, very modern. But the funny thing was, there was about 9 o'clock at night, and we went in, and here were all these young kids. And it was the only place that they had to go, this vast mausoleum. And all the party people, you know, from the, I suppose, the ruling elite, the clique, arrived at the opera house in their big limousines, in their furs and their jewels and their lounge suits. And they walked past everybody up into the opera. And all the soldiers were taking their girlfriends around and looking at these vast murals on the wall, exhorting the peasants to greater cooperation with the government. And all these young kids were trying to pull girls in this place. You know, they couldn't have been more than, you know, 14. There was nowhere else to go. There were a couple of bars we were wandering around, and it was like a minor revolution. I mean, they were just staring and falling off the seats, laughing at us, you know. And I was giving them my eagle eye stare, trying to shut them up, but it didn't do any good.
There's no exposure to anything over there. Nothing. In the way of rock and roll. Huh?
No. So next minute we were just standing looking over one of the balconies down onto the sort of main floor, and next minute I just looked aside and saw Johnny being hauled away. Like, they came in real fast and took
him. Yeah, it was really sudden because I was just looking at this mural, you know, and I turned around to walk off, and like I couldn't move because I was totally surrounded by these guys, you know, and these police. And like they just asked me for my passport, and like I said, can I have some identity as, you know, to who you are, and they just shouted passport at me again, you know. And so I looked around, there's nobody around, like the rest of the band were up further up the corridor, so I just took out my passport really nervously and handed it to them, and they walked off
with you know.
And like I had to race after them because they didn't explain anything to me why they wanted my passport or anything like that. And like you can't get out of East Berlin without a passport. So I was really stuck, so I raced after them. And they brought me downstairs, like from all the kind of glamour and all that, to this kind of cold concrete basement. Like, there's no windows, nothing, just stairs. And then there was this long corridor with just kind of steel doors all the way along, you know. And the rest of the bands were, like, Bob was saying, oh, we'll stick by you and all this kind of thing.
Yeah, we kind of went along and I said, what's happening? And they just went, like, just put their hands up at me, you know, and just didn't say a word.
They didn't try to do anything to any other member?
No, but we followed because there was 10 of us.
Yeah.
And then they just went into this room and slammed the door in our face. Mm. And next minute, the classic goon walked out, you know, bald head, you know, no neck. And
sounds just like Midnight Express.
Yeah, he looked like a large, really, big toe, you know.
Yeah.
That's sort of right. And with a Homburg hat. And he walked out. And then another guy walked out and we said, you know, we just were pissed off this stage. We didn't say, so we kicked the door. And the guy came out and we said, look, what is happening, you know? And he said, oh, you know, and he started indicating that Johnny was wearing night clothes, Nachtschloft or something, I don't know, whatever it was. And we said, yes, so. And he's going, no, you can't do that in East Germany, you see. So,
like when I walked,
don't laugh, people look at him in Fifth Avenue too.
Sure.
What's the difference?
So eventually they just came out and just said, they threw him out and they said, right, leave now. They escorted us to the door and said, you've got 5 minutes to get out of East Berlin. So we ran to the border.
Yeah.
But I mean, even scarier than that, the next day when we left West Berlin to drive to Hamburg, you have to drive through East Germany. And you must go at 50 miles an hour. And we left, we checked in and checked out and fine. We were driving through the border and we got 100 yards, I think, into East Germany. They stopped us. We were doing about 40. And the guys came up to us with machine guns and said, right, 150 West German marks, fine. Which is a lot of money, like, I don't know how many dollars it is. There's 4 marks to a pound. So that was, what, about 60 pounds, about $120. And for doing this, we said we were under the limit. They said, no, you weren't. And you've got no recourse. You know, it's like one of these places, like you hear it in Maryland or somewhere, where they just pull you, you know, to make money, make revenue. And
immediately, too, like they say, papers, you know, and you have to produce, everyone in the van has to produce papers, and they scrutinise them, and like it's an immediate heavy situation, you know, like you've no comeback. You can't say, you know, I'm not going to pay that, you know, or who are you, or anything like that.
Yeah.
It's just, that's gimme, you know?
Yeah, it's like, from what I could tell, the music, although I haven't heard that much that comes out of Germany, reflects that whole thing. I mean, if you just listen to somebody like Kraftwerk, and how stiff it is.
It's very cold, but I mean, but Berlin, they come from Berlin in particular. But there are...
Berlin is very different from the rest of Germany, you know?
We have Devo here, right? Yeah. And they are supposedly reflecting the robotism that goes on in Akron, Ohio. But they're doing it in a sense like, we can expose you to what's going on here. Take a look at it and check it out. There's such a difference in the political aspects of what's going on. It's really hard to believe that a place could still be like that.
Well, East Germany in particular, I mean, they really are... Well, the point about East Germany is that 60% of their entire annual revenue goes to Russia in some sort of feudal tithe, you know, and tribute. So I mean, when you're working on only 40% of the actual nation's output, things will get a little depressed. And but driving through East Germany, I said to you earlier, there was a Russian base 5 miles long, a Russian camp on either side of the road, and to actually see them with their like square shoulders and that, and there were tanks
the whole length of that 5 miles facing the road on either side of the sort of on either side
it
of
it is
the,
actually the an iron curtain, you know, like, I mean, all those tanks, you can just
thank you, Winston. But it was like it was frightening. I mean, like, to be confronted so close to realize they're an hour maximum from Hamburg and a couple hours from Paris. Mm-hmm. There's not very much you're going to do to stop them should they choose to start walking around, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'm not very political, but it did scare me. It scared me a lot.
Yeah.
And I'd imagine they'd be just... I imagine somebody from Soviet Union would be as scared to be in the West. But, I mean, mm-hmm. to go there and to have all, like, your... the propaganda and all confirmed almost is a funny sensation. It was depressing. It was hideously depressing. But we'll go back there again because, I mean, we just want to play really anywhere and just out of interest's sake.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of weird, you know. But, I mean, they tell us that when we go to Dallas this time around, then we'll probably get the same reaction from...
There's, this might sound like a naive question. There's a song on your album that makes reference to a particular person whose name has come up in a couple of rock and roll songs, Eva Braun.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know who Eva Braun is or was, and I would suspect there are some people in the audience who share that ignorance with me. What or who?
Eva Braun was Hitler's mistress. And it isn't contrary to what the song might suggest. It isn't a song about Hitler per se. It's about somebody who's incapable of love. And I think Hitler was incapable of loving anything or anybody.
So with the song being titled I Never Loved Eva Braun, it's actually... Is it supposed to be Hitler speaking in the
Hitler
song?
Hitler speaks in the song, but it's a kind of... it's not my personal viewpoint of that particular hideous monster.
Uh-huh.
It's the point of view that you take that here's this guy, and he goes back to Germany, say, in 1978... And they say, why did you do all this stuff? And he says, what, you know? And they say, you murdered all these people. And he denies it. His reasons for doing it, he believes in. It's like, I mean, Nixon, I don't think he actually knows his guilt. I don't think he actually believes his guilt. That's why he's never come out and said it. He accepts the responsibility, but he can't believe that he did it. And I think Hitler is the same way. I'm not comparing the two. But I think that... he must have felt the same way about it. I don't think anybody could confront themselves with what they did if you were that sort of person. And we used, the beginning of it sounds like the Shangri-La's leader of the pack,
right,
which I thought was quite funny. The idea of Hitler being the leader of the pack was quite amusing. So we have this, gee, are you really going out with Adolf?
Mm-hmm.
And then we have this David Bowie type thing, ooh yeah, which is Ziggy Stardust.
Right.
And Ziggy Stardust to me was the same sort of ugly character, a megalomaniac, a demagogue that Hitler was. So we have that reference in. And then Hitler says, I never loved Eva Braun. And all the guys in the band, all the girls, the Shangri-Las go, oh no? And he goes, no, 1,000 people say I did. So he uses that aspect of it really to deny everything he ever did. And then he says, I never heard the screams, I never saw the blood and gore, that wasn't part of the dream. The dream was maps and generals and uniforms, and like that was his whole thing, the big parades, you know, that's all he saw.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he was aware of what was going on, but he refused to count it, even though he ordered it. And then he like the middle of it has got that la 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 la, which isn't a million miles from la la da 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 da. And the reason for that is that's a reference, like the we put in that sort of oblique reference to Let's Spend the Night Together, because the idea of Hitler and Eva Braun getting it on is as difficult for me to visualize as my parents making it, you know.
Are you really going out with Adolf?
I enjoy doing things like that. They're amusing for me to do, and entertaining, and that's the best thing about it.
Yeah, the stuff about the way the writing on many of the songs is real nice to me, because so many of them are stories instead of just being something that doesn't go all that far. Most of them are like full rounded out stories. There was a song on the first album that I think you said will also be put on this new one that will be released soon in the States, Joey's on the Streets Again.
Yeah.
And last time I spoke to you, you told me the story of what that was all about.
Right.
And so I don't know if you could do it briefly, but would you want to talk about what that's all about again here? Because it's a great story.
Joey's on the Street Again, to anyone who has the first album, I apologize now for coming out on the second one. But the main reason we're doing this is because... the first one was never given a chance in the States, and we think that there's a hell of a lot of good songs in it, and we don't want to lose them.
Yeah.
And we're going to bring out maybe one or two songs on every album henceforth, or maybe put three tracks in a single and bring them out like that, so that people become aware of them anyway. And so we're picking Joey's on the Street Again from this album, because it's got a lot to do with the band, in as much as that it was written at the period when we were a local band in Dublin. And we played in this club called Morans, not Morons, Morans, or Morans, you'd probably say here.
Yeah, Morans.
And this guy who lived near us used to come down to the club, Joey, and he wasn't a good-looking guy or anything, he was a pretty weird guy. He used to just stand against a pillar in the club, just staring at us. And he used to get in for free. He used to carry around a pair of drumsticks, and he'd say to the guy at the door, "It's okay, I'm the drummer at the band, you know, you can let me in." So he used to get in free. And he disappeared for a while, and after about 6 months, one of us said, like, "Where's Joey?" And it turned out he'd got this girl pregnant, and he had married her. And like all such good and worthwhile marriages, it had broken up instantly. And he'd split, and he got a job in the docks in Dublin, and what eventually happened, and we heard, is that he got a knife in his back, and nobody actually knew whether he was killed or not, so it's not in the song, but we said no one quite believes that, all rumours are the same. And so we left it an open question, but it turned out that we were playing a gig in Derby in England, Northern England, and this guy turned up, and it was this Joey guy. He actually wrote to the New Musical Express and said to tell Geldof to stop saying I'm dead. I'm in fact alive.
Before, you were also mentioning that you'd be here to do some performing pretty soon. When is that, in a month or two?
It's our first gig in America.
Yeah.
The New World is the 24th of February, but like it's penciled in on that date, but we don't know really where we'd play. But it's a tour then, about 2.5 months of the States. Some gigs on our own.
Before we do our disco movie.
Yeah.
Don't invite me.
It's called Monday Night Fever.
Monday, okay. You had mentioned, and a couple of folks with you had mentioned, that perhaps some of them, like you just said, would be headlining, and some of them would be, I guess, second billing to
some
people.
Some of them would be headbanging.
Now, when I first spoke to you a while back, I remembered one time you were talking about your heavy opposition, which is felt by me and a lot of other people as well, to playing in places that are so large that the band can't feel you, right. Especially when you've got a reputation of having a real rave-up like you guys do when you play. So what happens for you if you run into a situation where they want you to play a real big place?
It depends to a large extent. I still hold that you cannot experience rock and roll in vast stadia. Peter Frampton is not real rock and roll, neither is Aerosmith, neither are any of these dangling puppets who do nothing but mouth platitudes, and that to me is not what rock and roll is about. And if it becomes impossible for us to communicate beyond a certain capacity, beyond a certain level, we will refuse just to play those places. Mm-hmm. Quite simple as that. If it is possible for us to communicate in a 60,000-seater stadium, which I'm very dubious about, and if it is possible for the people at the very back seat, up on the highest bleacher, to experience what we're experiencing on stage, then we'll do it, if that's possible. I personally don't believe it's possible. It was interesting this summer in that we did very big festivals in Europe and England. We did Nebworth in England, we did Bilzen in Belgium, and we did Rotterdam in Holland. And they had averaged about 80,000 people. And we played Nebworth in the afternoon, a very sunny Saturday afternoon at 3 o'clock.
This was a festival with a lot of other bands as well?
Yeah. Tubes were there, Frank Zappa, Peter Gabriel, Wilco Johnson, Nick Lowe, and the Rats. And we got there, Nick Lowe, Wilco was first on, then Nick Lowe, then us. About 3, it was a lovely afternoon, and I wouldn't have got up, I didn't care who was on, I'd have just laid back in the grass and fell asleep or something. And there was a lot of people there, and by 3:30, the whole place was on their feet dancing. And it's very difficult to get people to do that, especially if they're not particularly used to the music, and most of them would tend to dismiss us from English TV, I think, the people who were there. And because most of them were sort of, you know, in long hairs and people like that, who might not want to come and see us because they think that we're a certain type of band. And at the end of the hour that we played, the place was going crazy, and it was quite a triumph for us because we'd flown in, had 4 hours sleep and done the gig. And that was the first time that I realised that it was possible for us to come across to that. The next day we played Rotterdam, which had 80,000 people, the same thing occurred. And we played Bilzen. It's a 3-day festival. Lou Reed was headlining on the third day. We were second on the bill. The Jam were third on the bill, and a few others. And the Jam went down like a lead balloon.
Really?
And, yeah, that's not surprising. Don't sound so surprised.
Well, when they came here, the reaction was...
muted.
The audience was really...
this is a festival, though.
Yeah, the audience was really into them, although I must say that I liked their records better than I liked their live performance.
Yeah,
I love their records.
Well, their second album is so great, but that's a personal opinion. Mm. They came on, and we borrowed a lot of their gear because some of ours were in another place, and Lou Reed was on after us, and it was about 5:30, and when we finished it, it got dark, and it was the most amazing sight to see as far as you could possibly see, just people, their hands just going crazy, you know. And I mean, it's a bit Woodstock and all that, but if it's never happened to you, it's an amazing thing to experience, to be honest with you, like to watch it and to realise that you have done that and that people are dancing to your music. That's an incredible, like,
not only
feeling.
That they're dancing to yours, but that you know you've done something that's made so many people happy.
Yeah,
it must be
incredible.
Yeah,
it's a funny idea because you dance to other people's, you know, and write that as well.
Right.
And Lou Reed came on and stiff, mainly because he abused his own songs, which I can't tolerate. But he came on, but he was playing Prima Donna that day. He wouldn't leave his caravan, his trailer, until they had a red carpet from his trailer to the stage. You know, that sort of nonsense. Mm. When that happens,
his guitar came in a limo. You know,
when that happens, it's time to go.
Yeah, I would be surprised if he was doing something. Even though doing something like that is pretty rare, I'd be surprised if Lou was actually doing that seriously, as opposed to mocking, you know, the whole institution that lets people like the Eagles or bands like that actually do that in all seriousness. You know, Lou is like the great spoofer, even on himself.
I don't think he was spoofing. He was at the side of the stage screaming to get us off, as a matter of fact.
Well, perhaps he was definitely a threat, you know.
Oh, well, I mean, at that point...
An awful lot of bands that are afraid of the new rock and rollers that are better than they are.
Anyway, like, that's what happened. So it was a triumph for us again in that situation.
Yeah.
I've been into the huge arenas they play in America, and they're usually cold places to play and to
Have you been inside Madison Square Garden?
No, not yet. And but I mean, I don't know. Like, I mean, one thing I find equally as abhorrent as playing the Hollywood Bowl or somewhere like that is playing the bottom line or somewhere like that. I mean, it's the opposite extreme. It's totally cliquish and elitist. It's where all the freebies go, you know, the journalists, the DJs, the record company people. And playing to them, as I said to you earlier, is like playing to animated filing cabinets. And, I mean, they are there to judge us, and I will refuse to be judged, you know. I mean, it is not their prerogative to judge us. And I despise that whole setup. I despised it when I was actually... I used to be a journalist for a brief, inglorious period. And I imagined it as being totally a participatory thing. I mean,
who were you writing for?
I was writing for a Vancouver paper called George Strait. And, I mean, journalists are the same as people who watch sports at home on TV. Essentially, they're voyeurs. And that's fine. I mean, I dig voyeurism too. But they're not people I want particularly to play to. You're always constantly hung up with comparisons, and it's very hard to become totally involved in the gig. So I don't want to play. I mean, I've no particular objection to the actual place, the bottom line. I have an objection to CBGB's. We saw it for the first time the other day, and it's a pit.
Oh, that's the first time you've ever seen that place. Did you see somebody playing there, or did you just
go
in?
Yeah. I mean, it was enough. We went down to Max's Kansas City, and that's a hole as well. These hallowed halls of sort of the new bands I can do without.
It's just, you know, when it gets to the point, no matter how no matter how much support even, say, the club gives to new rock and roll bands, when it gets to the point where you go in there and you get stepped on and you can't see, which happens a lot, what's the purpose of going if you can't see the band?
It's the same as the Marquee in London. It's like, I mean, that, if you must think of a club that has a hallowed name. I mean, that band, or that club has played host to every band, every major rock band, you know, in its infancy. And we played there a few times, and I would like to say at this point that we had more people in the Marquee than Hendrix, the Stones, The Who, or Led Zeppelin. Thank you.
You said that last year.
And the place is like, it's a small little place, and they rip the bands off so badly. They rip the guys who come in to see the bands off. There's no air conditioning. We brought in our own fan blowers, and I still fainted on stage. And, like, I mean, you can't see. The audience is fainting just constantly. The front row just collapses. And the last time we played there, the place was jammed, right? There's a main room, and then there's a long corridor down to the door. And they were charging people to stand inside the door. Where, I mean, like, it's another room. You can't even see the
stage or anything like that, yeah. It's just inside the door.
Insane. And
do you think
there's... I hate clubs.
Yeah, I've often wondered, because I've worked... I did work, actually, for 6 or 8 months in the city in a club, which I have since given up. I've worked, you know, say, in radio. I've worked around music a bit, and I've come to wonder a lot lately about whether or not you think there would ever be a situation where all of the right people would be working together. So that, say, you have the right people who appreciate music and the bands and what they're going through, as well as appreciating the audience and what they need, running the club so that people aren't in there except for one purpose, which is to promote the rock and roll.
It's that's idealistic, and as such, it's fine, but it is a dream.
You don't experience that over in Europe anywhere.
Well, the nearest that you can get to that, really, I suppose, is Amsterdam, where that was tried with the Paradiso and the Milky Way. And it was tried in the true old fashion of peace, love, and what's so funny about peace, love, and understanding.
Right, exactly.
And it was... it was a brave attempt, which has since gone sour because the place has become decrepit. The people have got old and hardened. They've had to deal with big business, and as a result, they've become part of it. The whole experiment really has failed, but it's better than most other places, but still it's boring, fairly boring. And I'm afraid it's failed to a large extent. I don't mind. I mean, you must realise that rock and roll is founded on that ludicrous premise that all that glitters is gold. But underneath it all, everybody realises that all that glitters, in fact, is probably tin, if not worse. And to
or plastic. Move in any sort of...
Vinyl, that's what it is.
Right. To move in any sort of way through the rock and roll business, you must be equally as ruthless. And therefore you employ the Boomtown Rat or the Bob Geldof dictum, which I apply, and which I believe that, like, if you're to go head-on and meet a record company, because it's never, it's a very symbiotic relationship, there are very different things going on between a band and a record company, so you must use the thing like, you scratch my back and I'll claw yours.
Yeah.
And we keep our fingernails very well sharpened, you know. And you must employ that throughout. And, like, that's the way club managers think, is the way most people think in the business. And in the business, Christ, I never thought I'd get to the day when I said that. And it's a horrible thing to have to meet constantly, constantly. And I don't know if there's any way around it. I really don't, yeah. Because the bands who refuse to meet that die. The bands who are naive enough to think that it's just about music die. The ones who are innate businessmen like McCartney, Jagger, Dylan, Bowie are the superstars.
Right, yeah.
And because they could come to terms with that, they were essentially, I think, people who just love music. But they came to terms with the fact that what they were dealing with was something beyond that. The 50% of idealism and the 50% of the pragmatism that exists in rock and roll is like oil and water, and ne'er the twain shall meet, except on occasions when we go out for ludicrous lunches.
In the States are you headed for this time before you come back from
Boston, Philadelphia, Cleveland, Seattle, Minneapolis, LA, San Francisco, San Diego, Atlanta, Miami, Dallas.
Oh, you're going to Dallas this time?
Yeah. I mean, the only thing we know about Dallas is that it's the backdrop to a soap opera and an assassination,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's very hard to distinguish between the two most of the time.
And that there's also a great bootleg of the New York Dolls that comes out of Dallas as well, where they experienced that many years ago, probably what you'll still experience now, you know, a kind of hesitancy because of your supposed madmen behavior, as they said in Berlin. Yeah,
yeah, right. I don't know. I find the States an exciting place to be. It's definitely my favorite place, without a doubt, yeah.
Huh.
And... I don't know why that is. I experience a given type of manic freedom here, even though it is as restrictive as any country in the world. There is a sense of individuality which you don't find in Europe.
Yeah.
The fact that the Lone Ranger and John Wayne are heroes says more than enough about the States, which I love.
And Superman.
And Superman, right. I mean, truth, justice in the American way, I'll fight for that.
When you guys come back and do the tour, will you be stopping in New York first? Or do you not really know about that?
No, yet, really.
You kind of work up to it. A lot of bands that come over here sort of try to work up to New York because it's got
it's like Broadway,
kind of mythical reputation, yeah, that's the place. So they try to
Work around the country first. Listen, anybody listening to this, if you come and see a Rats gig, you might come to a Duff gig, you know. I mean, there's no working up to a gig I never believed in.
Right,
because there's some guy, the guitarist, wakes up in a bad mood. He's going to play a Duff gig. It's four or five or six people playing on a stage. No big deal. A guitarist does not have a monopoly on truth or perfection. He just plays a guitar. Yeah. And he can play a crap gig or he can play a great gig. And it isn't a big thing if you play a Duff gig, except that you've paid your money and you might feel a bit ripped off. Come again the next time, it might be a great gig. There's no consistency is the last refuge of the unimaginative, as somebody said, and I would hate to be consistent. A lot of the time we're good. Some of the time we're really good, brilliant. Some of the time I think we actually are the best rock and roll band in the world. And that's the way it'll be in America.
Yeah.
It might be that New York, and it might be one of those occasions which is really brilliant. A lot of it depends on you, the listener at home, on the audience. It is a participatory function. You don't... When we play a gig, we expect the audience to perform as much as the band.
Mm-hmm.
A really great
rock and roll gig occurs, when there is very little difference between the band and the audience. They are both feeling and experience the same thing. It is irrelevant who's making the music, because the place is just this incredible experience, a mutual shared thing. And if the audience leave as exhausted and as drained as the band leaves the stage, then it's been a success. Mm-hmm. If they don't, then somebody has failed. Yeah. And sometimes it's the audience.
Yeah, there. The last time that you came, you spoke about this. And as a matter of fact, the last time that you were here, when I spoke to you a little more than a year ago, that was still a real problem with audiences and rock and roll. Because I think there had been such a long time that had gone on that people weren't making good rock and roll records. There were people making good rock and roll records. Most of them didn't have contracts, and a lot of it wasn't into the media the way it is now. In the time span that has gone by since the last time you were in the States, if that was the last time, there's been a great improvement in that situation. I was telling you before, we every year have Richard Neer, who's one of the disc jockeys here, do a poll on the listeners as far as what impressed them the most throughout the year. And I'll have to show it to you on your way out, but the amount of good new rock and roll bands that showed up on there simply because of, in some cases, very little airplay was really encouraging. You know, if you stop and think what would happen if a lot of these bands were on more often, in greater numbers and stuff, rock and roll could just go crazy all over this country and every country.
Yeah, the
like
only thing
did.
Is that I find that, I mean, being interested in the whole rock and roll thing, not just playing in a band, I do read my Billboard, and one of the most noxious things I read in a long time was where they're doing this, I believe they call it superstar programming, and there's something like 30 major stations are now programming their stations where there is just Linda Ronstadt, Fleetwood Mac, the Eagles, Travolta, whatever. And that is all. Now, that is not radio. That's insidious propaganda that Muzak would be, you know, which just looks like small fry compared to.
Yeah.
And, I mean, not only is Linda Ronstadt a turkey, but if she grew another chin, she'd actually resemble one, you know. But, I mean, it's the worst sort of nonsense, you know. Like, I mean, I can't believe that people actually... Obviously, I understand the thing about commercialism, that stations need the support of their advertisers.
Oh, yeah, but there's definitely... You're right. I mean, there's a big difference between commercialism and brainwashing, and that's exactly what that is, what you're talking about. But I still think it's encouraging that the fact that so many of those stations do exist, and they are, or have been anyway, since their birth, which was only a few years ago, very successful, although now that the few progressive radio stations that are left are beginning to play more and more new rock and roll...
Right.
People are still willing to listen to this, to vote for it, to buy the records, to go to the shows.
Yeah.
Even though there is that brainwashing technique somewhere else on the dial, everybody hasn't been taken in by it yet,
it's
which gives me hope.
Evened out in England now, which we were talking about earlier, where I think that because of the radio situation in America, America is about 2 years behind England. What's happening here happened about 2 years ago, I think, where the acceptance began.
Right.
It's now sort of levelled out where the BBC, which is the bastion of radio conservatism in England, now, I would say, plays 50% of the new bands, because the kids no longer see a difference between the Bee Gees and the Rats, ABBA and Elvis Costello, I don't know, you know, any other bands. They actually don't see it as part of mainstream pop, which I always thought was precisely the point, to bring rock and roll back into the mainstream. And, like, Alf, who I said is here with us, has just, their readers' poll has just come in. And along with, like, you'd have a new band as the best band, along with, say, ELO second, then you might have Blondie third and the Queen fourth, or something like that, which I think is, I not only think is interesting, but I also think it's gratifying that now that has sorted out, there is a logical progression, that all the suspicion and trepidation that people met the new bands with, that they've nothing to do with rock and roll, has now gone by in England, and that they've actually not only, they haven't been assimilated into the mainstream, they've actually taken it over and dictated the course that music will go. And the bands who are around at the moment in England will dictate the course of music for the next 5 years until we're eventually kicked out in our horses, which is a good thing. And it just has to happen here. And the beginning of it, as I said, is indicated in your poll. And I just hope that we're
at the top of your poll next year, you bastards. Why didn't you vote for us?
You do see that as something that'll happen, that you will eventually be, say, put over the top the way a lot of the kids have put people like The Who and Led Zeppelin over
I
the
hope
top.
When we're no longer saying things that are interesting, uh-huh. and we no longer mean very much except that we go up and perform purely to earn some money,
right.
I hope by that stage people see through us
yeah.
and that they throw us out.
Well, I hope it doesn't get to that point. I sure like your records and you're right, and I would doubt that it would, but...
It depends very much
respect
on
to
the
you
people's
for that.
Attitude.
Yeah. yeah.
And if the attitude remains level, mm-hmm. If you're aware of what's going on, it's very easy to be aware of what's going on. You don't have to live in L.A. palaces and become unaware, you know. I think then you should maintain it. Ultimately, it's down to the songs, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Rolling Stones, after 16 years, are still bringing out tracks which mm-hmm. are superlative in any standard. Bob Dylan, if you ignore his last two albums, brought out Blood in the Tracks after X many years of creativity, and it is one of the best albums I've ever heard. Mm-hmm. And if people can do that, I don't care what age they are, I don't care where they live, if they can do that, they're all right in BG's book.